Knuckles Comic Issue 16. We start out right away with Knuckles meeting with his mother, although I wondered if Lara was teleporting or something in the first few panels. She hugs him while saying that she was worried about him, which is sweet. It's revealed that Lara's husband, Wen, already knew about Knuckles being back, and after Knuckles gets worried about his mother asking him how he got back home, we see a menacing airship reach the floating island entering stealth mode, and then entering through the holographically cloaked portal. This portal served as a gateway to Haven, and the person in the airship says that he's been here before. I thought the airship was piloted by Snively at first and they made a detour, probably because it looks so menacing. Everyone of the Unnecessary Brotherhood gathers to discuss Knuckles being more powerful. And we cut back to Lara being stunned at Knuckles creating a portal. For some reason, Lara looks sad at this instead of immediately proud of him, and explains that he'll have to ask his father what happened between his normal birth and his hatching. Hatching, that's right. Echidnas in the real world do lay eggs. So Mobians who lay eggs simply call that giving birth. That's interesting, if confusing. We see Lara asking Locke why she can't see her baby, and Locke says that the doctor simply wants to run some tests to make sure everything is alright. Sure. Lara explains that it normally takes 3 days between birth and hatching, but only a day later and she was holding Knuckles in her arms. And she didn't ask any questions? Well, maybe she did off screen, but she doesn't seem too concerned. Everything seemed fine until months later when she found him playing with blocks, spelling words far in advance of his age level before he could even speak. Words that even his mother had trouble with sometimes. So not only is Comic Knuckles not a total idiot, not only does he show moments of insecurity, not only is he paranoid sometimes rather than being gullible in the slightest, but he was shown to be a prodigy when he was a baby. Well, it is Comic Knuckles. But of course, he still fell for Robotnik's line stuff, so he's not totally out of character. He still has some moments of dizziness. It was Locke who was supervising Knuckles' training and determined what was in his best interest. This we already know. We already know Lara didn't have any real power in raising her own son. So this is really pointless. Although I see equals MC squared here, and it's weird to think that Knuckles of all people was taught about that. Again, I imagine Knuckles as being very uneducated. Feeling out of her depth, Lara went to her mother Jenna for advice. I like how Jenna's a gardener. Like, it's charming. Jenna says that relationships are not about equality, they're about give and take. Isn't that the same thing, as long as what's taken and given are equal in value? Although, I guess it's kind of hard to quantify what's equal in value. It's annoying how she sides with Locke over her own daughter. I like how Lara lampshades it. I'm his mother! Her role in things was to set an example for him as the kind of good person he could become. I guess that makes sense for the Guardian's wife. Jenna says that she's happy things turned out the way they did for her, and that she'd be lost without her darling Saber. Saber, that's Athera's kid. So what's she talking about? I thought she was talking about her husband at first. Then we see the Brotherhood, some of which immediately show huge hypocrisy over the technology ban, but one of them clearly having cyborg eyes. I thought cybernetics were restricted to members of the Dark Legion. I mean, isn't that the whole reason that people know that Julie is a previous Dark Legionnaire on site? Because she has cybernetic dreadlock? You'd think if anything would be banned by technology ban to be cybernetics, but I guess cyborg eyes are just considered to be a part of medical technology, and it's okay as long as you need them. I don't know why I'm complaining. I'm glad it can evolve to join some futuristic technology, because it was feeling more like a regular city recently. Anyways, the cyborg guy, Tober, says that everything is peaceful in the Dragon Kingdom, although he complains about how Sonic was a hero and got rid of the Eternal Fire in it. Really? You're complaining about that? And this would make sense based on what we know about him later, but the thing is that it's not like any of the other echidnas around him disagree with him and call him out on complaining about Sonic being a hero. So it's not just him who's against Sonic being a hero, it's everyone here. And then another guy has the nerve to complain about Sonic supposedly being nothing but trouble down under. Well, God forbid he saved some of the lives of the down under freedom fighters. What are you guys, League Eggman? At least Saber, which is apparently the name of Locke's father, tells him to stop complaining about the hedgehog. He complains that things have gotten more chaotic without Eggman as his lieutenants want to take over their little fiefdoms. You mean the ones they've always been running since Eggman anyways? What's the difference? Wait, there are disciples of Dimitri? You mean the Dark Legion, right? Just say that. We don't need to see the word disciples in a Sonic comic. Then they get advice from their council of advisors, who are all Fire Ant Movians. Well, I shouldn't have been too surprised. One of them says that the Brotherhood's purpose lacks focus, and they should consider whether their duties have outgrown their original intent. But they didn't fucking do anything! For the most part, it was Sonic and his friends who did all the work against Eggman. One of the ants says that the purpose of the Brotherhood is to look after Echidna interests on a global scale, so they're just the government of Echidnapolis. Just call them that then. The ant says that outside interests can affect Echidna interests, so their only choice to avoid becoming irrelevant on a global scale is to become a force to lead Echidnas and the other species of the planet into a new golden age. And other species? How is that their business? I don't like how that was phrased. Meanwhile, Knuckles sits down for dinner with his mom and stepdad, with his stepdad saying that the meal he cooked was called Duck with the Exquisite. Okay, so I guess in Mobius French, Allah is written with the law connected to the but that doesn't explain why he used an adjective like exquisite after it instead of the name of a flavoring. He could have just said exquisite canard and made more sense that way. Maybe he's just being cheeky by doing it wrong. It is interesting that he knows a bit of French, shows that he's more educated by bothering to learn that. In such a short time too, as I doubt his hyperzone of Echidnapolis had extensive access to a language that wasn't used in it. I was pretty annoyed when Knuckles ran off unhappily at Lara saying that Wynn was going to marry her. Okay, that is a typical child's reaction having a stepfather marry his mother when he hasn't warmed up to him enough yet. He doesn't want to feel like he's replacing his dad, and thus betraying him. And it makes sense that he'd regress and act like a child, because he hasn't been with his mom since he was a kid. But still, it's not like he hates Wynn. He liked him before. Also, I thought Wynn and Lara were already married. Sure, Wynn was described as her consort, but I thought that was just a fancy Echidna title for it as a result of her being the royal lady and him not being a guardian. Probably because he was already living with her anyways, so I just assumed they were already married. The chaotic spot Knuckles running away was Vector saying that he's making tracks at supersonic speed. Does he mean literally? Can he run as fast as Sonic now? That is accurate to the games, but why him and not Tails? Well, he is more powerful than him at this point, I guess. But this comes out of nowhere. Unfortunately, when Julie Sue says she should go after him instead, Vector argues and bickers with her, so it looks like he still hates her, even after that whole arc he had with her. I mean, God, you jump her once and she fights back, and you're still on that. At least Espio takes her side. Then we see the Brotherhood finally talking about Knuckles. Grandfather Spectre, another Echidna who looks sort of like a cyborg with no mention of a lifting of the technology ban in sight, says that he warned Locke about messing with the natural order of things. I can't believe they're talking that they think Knuckles is a villain. These guys are like the most genre-blind people around. They sure love to jump to conclusions. Dimitri comparison or not, this really feels like an artificial conflict. They should just be going, yippee! Knuckles is super competent! He's gonna be the greatest guardian ever! Knuckles tells Julie that he'd rather be alone, and I like their snarky interaction after she sits down anyways. You don't listen very well, do you? Especially not to you, that's for sure. Then out of nowhere, even though they had just barely become friends, Julie gives him a kiss on the cheek. Knuckles is a good audience surrogate here by pointing out how weird that was, saying, I'm not sure I even like you. I know the real reason why she did that, but she certainly doesn't. And her answer is that she was just repaying him for trying to cheer her up about being an outcast. Then they have some more bickering as they sit in front of a full moon, with Knuckles saying, don't ever do that again. And he thinks to himself that the kiss actually felt kinda nice, while Julie thinks that she actually would do it again, but isn't sure why. I just wish they got the chance to spend more time together as friends before this could happen. Julie is certainly more forwards than Bunny or Sonic, I get that, and she had a lot of time to dwell on how much Knuckles wanting to cheer up meant to her. But still, how much time have they actually spent together? They spent hours looking for an earthquake place, went to Echidnapolis, it got transported to Angel Island again, and then they spent all day fruitlessly looking for Knuckles' friends. That is barely even 2 days of time together. And I don't... Well, how long did it take for the Echidnapolis getting transported to the island thing? A couple days? But still, that's not even a week of time together. And I don't think it was even quality time. But at the very least, they do have a lot of personality traits in common. She's basically a spunky female Knuckles. And that makes this feel way less forced than Sonic and Sally. But again, they better spend more time together as friends instead of being strangled by the red string like I've been fearing. Also, the text blurb says that this is the first time they're seeing a kindred spirit in each other, but Knuckles clearly introduced Julie to his friends as having things in common with them. This story was written by Ken Penders, and involved Knuckles finally getting to have more of a talk with his mother, although it was sadly short-lived, as all that happened was a flashback where Lara's mother didn't take her side, and Knuckles not wanting Wynn's Mary's mother, something that should have happened a long time ago. It makes sense that we didn't get to see that since Knuckles is the main character, so we should find it out through him. And he's not that important a character anyways. Speaking of non-important characters, the Brotherhood. They're just the akin to government. Just call them that. They talk as if they do important things to help out the world and fight villains, but they never did anything. At the time of this recording, I only know of one important thing they did. If they're so valuable, why did I never see them before? Most importantly, these unnecessary jerks actually have the nerve to complain about Sonic being a hero and treat him like the villain. And then they do the same for Knuckles. These guys should all be fired. Out of a cannon. Into the sun. Not to mention a few of them are cyborgs, which is pretty hypocritical. I thought that was only a Dark Legion thing. If the technology ban has been lifted, just tell us that already. All this akin to world building, and they didn't explain that. But of course, why have a futuristic city? The whole reason I liked the Cannon Falls in the first place, if you're not going to use the technology.